basically, I started getting curious about why do we tell stories? We're the only animal that does. We're actually, if you think about it, we are the only animals that actually have a brain that's capable of compiling an autobiography that follows us all the way through our lives. No other animal has that. You're continually editing, revising, adding to your personal autobiography. So, why do we do this? First of all, it has to do with the brain being as efficient as it can be. It takes a lot of energy to run a brain. So, brains actually do a lot of shortcutting. This is one of the ways they shortcut. And if you think about the way that information comes in and comes out of our brain, it's all pretty much linear. We're getting a lot of words coming in one at a time, and we actually have to send the words back out one at a time. So if we have to retell everything, detail by detail, every single time, that's not efficient. It's not efficient in our interactions. It's not efficient in how we store information in our minds. So we shortcut. And that's for stories. I'll give you a perfect example. I say 9/11. You know exactly what I'm talking about. Now, your experience and my experience of 9/11 are not the same, but we have a common reference point. I don't have to say terrorists, buildings, falling planes. I don't have to say all that detail. You know what I mean. So we have all these ways of shortcutting things. So that's part of the reason that humans do story the way we do. What's also interesting is that stories have natural limitations built into them. And this explains why our stories look the way they do and sound the way they do. They have a lot of common traits. We have this way of looking at stories that's very linear. This happened, then this happened. And also, this happened because this happened. There's a lot of why and because in our stories. They're used to explain things. Here's the thing about this, though. In reality, events are much more complex than a linear narrative gives us. So, just as an example, who knows the story of Charlotte's Web? Not all of you know it, it's fine. So, Charlotte's Web is about a pig and a spider and their amazing relationship, where the spider actually, this pig is probably going to be slaughtered for food, and by the end of the story, the spider has very likely saved his life. It's a really cool, heartwarming story. And you might just say, well, he gets a chance to live because of all the things that the spider did. Be a really simple way to say it. Here's what's cool on the internet. You can find this and make people think this stuff through in fascinating ways. Check this out. Here's Wilbur's chance to live. Look at all the things that actually had to happen for him to get that chance to live. So you don't even have to read all this. Just notice the complexity of that result, what created it. What I'm saying is, I think our lives are also that complex. There's so much going on, and there's so little of it that we actually focus on or remember. So lots of interesting stuff here. I know we could spend a lot of time talking about Charlotte's Web. Meanwhile, what I want to also share with you is the fact that our memories are vulnerable. We've known this for a while, and now we have some amazing research that actually shows us how this looks, how our memories are vulnerable, and to the fact that every time you take the memory out and look at it, you're actually poking at it. You're actually changing it in some very subtle ways. So memories are not exactly like videotapes or DVDs. We mess with these things all the time, and other people do too, and we don't often know that that's happening. Biases are natural shortcuts that your brain takes that were probably really, really useful as we had to survive in the wild, and sometimes not so useful now. Sometimes yes. This has been known, by the way, this one, for over 2,000 years. So the early philosophers actually had a pretty good take on, oh, we do this. If you think about how science experiments were conducted, scientists actually use their knowledge of confirmation bias to do what's called double-blind studies, you know, so that the researcher doesn't know who's getting the placebo and who's getting the real pill, so that the researcher won't unconsciously influence the result. So we know this happens all the time. And it influences how we look at our lives, what we naturally filter out. Confirmation confirmation bias. You can show people evidence till the cows come home. If they're not into it, they're not into it. It doesn't matter. They believe what they believe. So, and I'm not saying that just about this person. We all have our own versions of this. We all have our own versions of being completely incapable of taking in conflicting information. We are pattern-seeking creatures. We will find patterns anywhere. All animals do this. We do it really, really well. We do it so well, we don't even know we're doing it. We're finding patterns all over the place. We're matching up things that are coincidental and saying, oh, it couldn't possibly be coincidence. And probably if you're the person to whom this happened, he tripped on a banana peel because someone put it there and he shouldn't have. If you're watching, you're more likely to attribute it to his personality. Say he's clumsy, he doesn't look where he's going to trip because he's inattentive. So right away we have two parallel stories going on for the same event, depending on whether it happened to you or whether you observed it. If it's really good, if something really good happened, it's because of who I am. If it's not so good, it's because of the external circumstances, the things that happened to me. So we are heroes of stories that have great outcomes, and we're victims of stories that don't have such great outcomes.